So good afternoon, and I'll begin with more, which is not nucleosynthesis or what I'm supposed to talk, but actually it comes, I think, very nicely in the context of this school, because this towards the end of the school I will be able to check if you learned something in this school. So there are two exercises, two questions, and this time, also the lecturers are encouraged to participate in answering. So, you've just seen light curves of supernova, and with the absorption lines and emission lines, and we learned how to interpret them. So, this is from a supernova that should have been famous. It's not as famous as it should be. But the name is hidden here. And the question, what do we see here, which is unique? Don't worry. I don't expect you to really come up quickly with an answer. I would not know to answer this. This was answered by Mazzali at 2000. And it is not 98 BW. And you see here two fits for this for the light curve, for the spectrum, the solid line, which he believes is the correct one, and the dashed one, which is not so good. And this is the interpretation. This is supernova 97EF. And the observed line is the observations. And then the thick line is the better fit. And here we have a standard supernova model, but to this something is added. So what is the component which has been added here to the standard supernova? And this is what has been added. Oops. This is the standard supernova. This is now density, this is now distance, or sorry, this is velocity, and this is density. And this is the logarithmic and the logarithmic. And this is the thing which have been modified to get a better fit to the spectrum. And this modification to get a better fit of the spectrum looks not very significant, because it is it's small densities, it's low densities, but high velocities. So it may not be so significant. What is seen here, and I forgot to say that this was seen, this addition to the spectrum was observed only early on. These observations were about 5 days. The spectrum was taken about 5 or 6 days after so it was an early spectrum. And it disappeared. You didn't see it later. The fact that you didn't see it later means that what it was due to the outermost layer of the expanding ejecta. And this outermost layer, as it things expanded, became completely transparent, and these lines disappeared. And so later on, you didn't see it. So this was this modification, which is here at relatively low density and high velocities. And you see here the velocity are about 20,000-30,000 kilometers per second. So it's about 0.1 C. Now this looks like a small change. And this is one supernova. But it is more interesting if we look at the energy which is involved. And to get the energy which is involved, we have to multiply by V squared. And of course, when you multiply by V squared, this will jump up. So this is what is happening when we see the same curve. This is the same supernova, EF, and other supernova, including 98 BW. Now, with the log of the energy and log of the velocity. And so this is the average velocity of the supernova, but this is this additional high energy component, which is about 0, 1 or more C. It's quite a lot of energy. Now the second question, which is again a question, now it's a real question to the audience. How can you do that? How can we get on the top, on the outermost part of the supernova, a shell with low mass but high velocity and significant amount of energy, which is just at the outermost part of the supernova? And to give you a hint, I'll show something which you've already seen, the solution of what happens in when you have a shock wave which is propagating out in a decreasing density. When you have a shock wave which is propagating out in a decreasing density, you get smaller and smaller amount of material moving at faster and faster velocity, and the energy is decreasing, like V to the minus 5, at high energy. This is when you have a spherical solution of a shock wave propagating in a decreasing density profile, which corresponds to a stellar atmosphere. So this is what you expect. This is what you see. So the question now is, how can you get something like this? Can you come with some scenario that can get this? This is the puzzle. And this puzzle was standing around for almost 20 years. I mean, Mazzali et al. Wrote this paper in 2000, and without an explanation, without a model to what is going on, they just described the results. And these other supernova were accumulated in the meantime, with similar, some of them with similar behavior. By the way, this is seen, as far as I know, and I'm not an expert in the field, unfortunately, Avishai is not here, but I don't know of any supernova that was bright and observed early on that did not show this component. There may be, I don't know. So how can you do this? This is very strange. You expect this. You get this. This picture here tells us that you cannot get this in a simple spherical model. You must get the energy out in a non-spherical way out from the center and then spread it out. Because if you try to do it spherically, this is what you will get. So luckily, by now, we know how you get a non-spherical action. If you have a jet which is operating inside, the jet does not have to get out. It's sufficient that there is a jet inside. The jet can push some material in and produce a cocoon. The cocoon may or may not break out. But even if the jet may or may not break out, but the cocoon, which has significant of energy, will break out in a non-symmetric way. And once it breaks out, it will spill sideways and surround the supernova. So this is actually a very old simulation, which I did with Martin Obergaulinger already in 2013. Trying to see what happens to a choked jet. So this is, the jet was expanding. We stopped powering the jet. It got stuck in the supernova. But we didn't push it far enough to see what will happen later. And this is what is happening if you do the full simulation. This is the simulations of ore, which you've already seen in, this is the stellar surface. This is a choked jet. The jet is dead by now, but the cocoon is going out. And then there is no jet, but this material, this hot material from the cocoon spreads around. And this is what we observe, what we may observe in this situation. This is, I cannot prove that this is the answer to what we have seen here, but I don't know of any answer how to get this fast-moving material. I and some of my colleagues, including Udi, who is sitting here, do not know of a better answer how to spread relativistic material in a small amount of matter around the supernova as has been observed here. So this is sort of the final situation. This is the moment of breakout, the cocoon at breakout, and this is the cocoon later, just the final picture of the end of our simulation surrounding the star. The star is here at the center. An observer will see this. Of course, an observer will see asphericity, and there is also evidence for asphericity, quite a lot of evidence for asphericity in supernova. So this was seen in about half a dozen supernova, including supernova like 98 BW, in which we know that there was a gamma ray burst, there was a jet, some sort of a jet there. So it was seen in other supernova. From the amount of relativistic material, we can estimate the properties of the jet that died or powered the cocoon. And we see that it is a significant amount of energy. For example, in this case, in EF, the total energy of the supernova was about 2 × 10^52, but the energy of the jet was 9 × 10^51. So it's comparable, but it's not more than that. It's always less than the energy of the supernova. In some case, it is much less. This is in 98 BW. And in 98 BW, there was an independent evidence for relativistic outflow from the radio emission. So you don't even need that. Most of the supernova here are type 1BC, broad lines 1BC. But there is also one regular type 2B. Regular, I mean, core collapse, super regular, standard, more standard core collapse that shows such a behavior. And we can even infer in such some cases what is the width of the jet. So what does it tell us? It tells us that there is evidence for a hidden activity of jets in many supernova. And this is important because this supports the statements that Udi was making yesterday about the activity of supernova and the GRBs, that there are two engines. There is one engine which is sort of more spherical, which is responsible for the overall expansion of the ejecta, a more standard engine, maybe a neutrino-driven, the standard neutrino-driven supernova, maybe something else. But there is also evidence in regular supernova for a jet activity, and a jet-like activity involves some rotation at the center or something like this. So in this sense, Lars, I was telling that I will show some evidence supporting your ideas of magnetars, because magnetar-like activity is something which more naturally may produce a jet like this. I don't know what is producing the jet. We don't know from this what is producing the jet, but it is very interesting that jets are in supernova. Yes? It is very well consistent with the gamma ray, because if you remember Woody's talk, we believe that the 98 BW, which was a low luminosity gamma ray burst, was a shock breakout. So what actually would believe that this is the whole story in 98 BW. This, what we saw is the breakout of the cocoon. The gamma rays in this in 98 BW were not the standard gamma rays. They were the breakout. They were the breakout of the cocoon, which we happen to see in that case. And they are much, much less energetic than the energy that we have here, which is the standard story about shock breakout. The thing that you see just the shock breakout is can be orders of magnitude less than the total energy which is involved. So this is fully consistent with this idea.
And do you have the same analysis for 2009?
Unfortunately, not. I'm not an observer, so the only data that we used was the data which was given us from by Paolo and Elena. So this was done with Elena Pian and Paolo Mazzali, and the only data that we have is data given to them. And I think that all these cases were actually cases which are already published.
Okay.
So there is even not a new data here. Yes, they're all published. They told us that there is they're writing a more detailed paper with more cases like this. But I haven't seen the. This was in the last summer, and we were supposed to revise. We got the FRA report in the middle of August. You know what happened in the middle of August. None of us came back to this. Okay, the last thing that I want to say about this, that it may be more interesting than just that, because if there are jets in this supernova, then this suggests immediately for a kind of multi-messenger information from supernova than we know so far. One is that there is, in all these shocks which are happening here in the center of the star, there is a possibility that you produce high energy neutrinos in this process of the jet being choked by the stellar core or by the stellar atmosphere. So there is a possibility of high energy neutrinos. And the last thing, which the first version of this was written up with Ofik Birnholz, who is now at the LIGO team, and then Eli Leiderschneider is doing the next version of this now, is that in the acceleration process of the jet itself, just in the fact that you start from material which is at rest, or energy which is at rest, and you accelerate it to relativistic velocity, just this fact generates gravitational waves. These gravitational waves are most likely not in the LIGO band. They are in the tens of millihertz. So not even in LISA band. So something like DESIGO, which is a Japanese proposal, could have detected them. But there is an option that somebody, these things will be detected. And then they will teach us exactly, just like from the gravitational waves that we saw now from the neutron star merger, they'll teach us exactly how the jet launching process took place and how things are evolving. So this is for the future. Yeah, these are the neutrinos which are here. Okay, so having said all that, I will go now to what I'm really supposed to talk, is the nucleosynthesis and in mergers and how this is related to what we have seen the merger in August. So this is the abundance curve of elements normalized to silicon for some reason, but this is the solar abundance, which is typical for the rest of the universe. And I'll be focusing here on these elements from here, on these heavy elements. And these heavy elements are considered to be R-process elements. And I'll explain in a second what I mean by R-process elements. And in fact, this is the iron peak. And everything down below the iron peak is produced in a regular process in stars. We know the story that the stars begin with helium, with hydrogen, go to helium, and so on. And this is all the way up to iron. And the question is above the iron. And there are three broad peaks here of the R process elements. And the question is, what is happening in these peaks? And you can see they are much, much more rare than the standard elements that we see here. So there are two processes in which you, there are actually more than two, but there are two main processes in which you synthesize a nuclei. One is the slow process. In a slow process, slow is determined, slow or rapid, determined by the question, how fast are the neutrons captured or protons captured compared to beta decay? A slow process means that the capture rate of neutrons is slow, and the nuclei have time to beta decay before the next nucleus is captured. So what you could see here, you add one neutron, neutrons go in this direction, protons in this direction, you add one neutron, this element is unstable, it sits there, it decays to here, you add another neutron, this is stable, okay, you add another neutron, and so on until you reach this point. This point is now unstable, you go to here, this is unstable, you go to here, and you slowly build up. But you can see immediately that there are objects, that are elements here, which are populated. And if you're just trying to do everything by this process, how can you get to this isotopes here? Because before you get to here, you decay, and you still have some significant abundance of these isotopes. So this means that something else exists. Now, where this is happening? This is happening in typical slow processes inside stars, if you sometimes go beyond iron or so on. So this is the slow process. What is the fast process? The fast process, it's the opposite thing. You capture neutrons faster than the decay. So then you mean that you go quickly in this direction, you add neutrons, and then you decay. Then you go fast, you don't care if these isotopes in the center are stable or not, because you, before the isotope had a chance to decay, you capture another neutron, and you become, you move to another isotope, until you eventually decay and you go in zigzag like this. But so this is the essence of rapid process. And for this, it is clear that to be in rapid process, you have to have quite a large flux of neutrons around you. Otherwise, you cannot be in this situation. So it has to be a situation in which you have many available neutrons. And the way to describe availability of neutrons is by this quantity YE. And YE, which actually measures the amount of electrons. But if you have small number of electrons relative to the total mass, this means that you have a small number of protons. This means that you have a lot of neutrons. So small YE is a lot of neutrons. Higher YE is you have fewer neutrons. So this process prefers a lot of free neutrons around. So this is again a demonstration of, for example, an isotope which is sitting here. This is isolated by two unstable elements from an S process. Still, such things exist, and this is a proof that our process exists. But in general, if you want to go to very high region in the atomic table, then you have to have this process. Okay. So, what I showed here, I'll show it once more. So a natural place to have our process is in a decay of a neutron star matter. And this was realized already in 74 by Latimer and Schramm. It was really very early on. And the motivation at that time was that already then they sensed that supernova are not good, which was the classical model. Supernova was the classical model to produce our process. Do not really favor the right conditions to produce our process. Now, after about, this was 74, so after 40 years, there is kind of a general agreement among people who are doing supernova research that indeed, in standard supernova, the conditions are not suitable for our process, definitely not to go beyond the second peak. So this motivated Latimer and Schramm. And of course, the natural place to get this neutron star matter decay is if you have a neutron star merger. Actually, they considered neutron star black hole merger. And in this process, the tidal disruption of the neutron star matter will throw to space some neutron free matter. And this will maybe the way to produce our process. So this is how it works. So what we begin here with a neutron star matter. we begin to throw it to space to let it expand. So we have here the time. This is the energy generation as function of time. What you see here in the top is the energy generation. This is the composition at any moment of time. And here you will see where are the isotopes at every stage along the evolution. And just to remind you, this is the value of stability. This is the number of neutrons, and this is the number of protons. So in black, these are the stable isotopes. So this is where we are. We end. We must end here. And the question is whether if you do this exercise of taking matter and throwing out to neutron star matter, throwing out to space, following the various beta decays, do you get to the right place? So this is the question. It was addressed more systematically for the first time by Freiberghaus, Tillmann, and Rosbrock in 1999. Since then, it was followed by many people. And this is from a simulation by Koropkin and Rosbrock. But there are several other groups who follow this. So let's see this movie now. So we begin. The matter is now very Newton rich. You see it's below here. This is the energy generation. And then things go and eventually decay and remain here. So this ends actually at about 3 seconds after the beginning. So this ends very quickly. And this is the final composition. And indeed, you see the peaks there. The peaks arise naturally because they are associated with the nuclear magic numbers. And so the three peaks are built in there. You reach more or less the final abundance that is observed. And basically, almost all the action ends here, this is 30 seconds, not 3 seconds. Almost all the action ends here, but this is not really that everything ends here, because still around here, you have still many radioactive isotopes, and these radioactive isotopes will continue to produce heat, and this is what we'll continue to estimate later, just now, for longer time scales. But there was a question, yes?
What are the axes of the inner figure?
This figure? This is, again, this is the time, and this is the energy generation, the energy generation rate. So there is some deep here, which due to some nuclear physics thing that I don't understand. And then it goes down to, and it continues t to the minus, more or less as t to the minus 1/3, 1.3 over a very long time scale. Now, when doing these calculations, one has to be, the final results depend critically on the initial YE. This is very important for the rest that we are going to discuss now. If the YE is low, then low is less than about 0.2 or 0.15. If it's sufficiently low, then we can go all the way to the second and third peaks. If it is high, above about 0.2, then you still have a lot of neutrons, but it is not high enough, and you produce, it is not low enough, and you produce only the first peak, which is around barium, if I'm not mistaken. So different YEs will produce, different initial YEs will produce different compositions, and this is very important to what we are going to see in neutron star mergers, in the context of and in the context of what we have observed in this merger now. So this was already shown before. This is a composition of a kind of a plot of the different ingredients of the ejected matter. So the important thing is that there are two basic ingredients, two different competing ingredients. One is the dynamically ejected material. Dynamically ejected material is pure neutron star matter. And as a pure neutron star matter, you have a very small YE. So this is going to produce all the heaviest, all the elements up to the heaviest ones. Now, there is another component, which is arriving from winds. And there are two sources for the winds. The winds can come from an accretion disk that forms around the central object, or from, if you have a proton-neutron star, if things do not collapse directly to a black hole, and there is a phase of few, of about half a second or so, depending on equation of state and the total mass, that you have a proto-neutron star, which is heavy, it is heavy object. It will eventually collapse to a black hole, but it is hovering before it collapses as a heavy 2.8 or 2.7 solar masses neutron star. Then the neutrino flux from this hot material will also drive a wind. So there are two sources of the wind. Now the wind, if you remember the earlier discussion today, is driven by the neutrinos. And the wind which is driven by the neutrinos, since the neutrinos are driving the wind, this implies immediately that you'll have less neutrons in the wind. And this is expected to have a high YE material. So in the material which is coming from the wind, we expect to have a less heavy composition. And in the material which is coming from the dynamical ejecta, we expect to have heavier composition. So this is quite important. Yes?
So how does our process depend on the temperature and density of this ejecta? Is that sensitive or not so sensitive?
I think, I'm not sure, I'm not an expert on that. As far as I know, you don't want it to be in a very hot situation. This is why the regular supernova scenario does not work, because the material is too hot. You want it to be in a cooler, in a relatively cold situation. And here, in this situation, in the dynamical ejecta, the dynamical ejecta is relatively cool. But I'm not an expert on that, so if somebody in the audience knows a better answer, Udi?
Not much, but in principle, you want to have the right density and the right temperature. It's too high, it wouldn't work. Of course, the neutron star itself is neutron rich, but it's not made up of alpha. You need the decomposition, the expansion of the neutron rich material is what's giving you the chance to make this nucleotide. Now, in this case, when everything is expanding, you are basically scanning this row in T. And you get to the point where you can produce whatever you want. Another interesting point here is that the final abundances that you get, so the exact abundances, are not depending very strongly on this condition. Again, now I'm just quoting things that I heard, but I don't understand. Is that you have, at least when you produce everything up to the 30, you have a recycling. So you produce everything, and then beyond the 30, everything, you have fission which brings you back to the beginning. So it's not very depending on the exact condition. You will almost always get something which is rather similar to what you observe here. If you get into details, then there are problems. Then the predictions, what you see, are not exactly. But broadly speaking, and also as far as I know, if you look at different locations in the universe, you see rather similar abundance patterns.
Yeah, you
not
see.
Extremely, yes. Depending on the condition. And the neutron star merger, when things are thrown out, you go through the region where you produce this material and rather robust.
It is, yeah, the first peak you can possibly also get in without this whole story. But the nice thing is that the whole second and third peak come as and go as a group. So this is what Udi said. This pattern is sort of regular, and you can have in different stars less or more, but you don't see stars when suddenly there is a dip here or a huge peak, a huge difference between the first, the second, and third peak. But you're right. The first, second, and third. The first relative to second and third, you can vary. Yeah. Okay. So this is the long, again from this paper by Koropkin, the long term radioactive decay. And so this is the logarithmic time and here it is in days. So we are interested in this region between day and 10 days. This is the observed region when we see macronova, which are powered by powered by this radioactive decay. And there's some early phase, which is a fraction of a second, and then things saturates to this T to the minus 1.3. And there are variabilities, but not very strong depending on the initial YE. At late time, this does not depend very sensitively. And there are different groups, so this is different. There are at least two groups here on this curves here. Roughly speaking, and this is relates to Sterl's talk, if you have a series of radioactive isotopes with different time scales, if they were emitting the same amount of energy, then you'll get simply 1 over T as the decay. Because simply, if you have the same equal amount of energy, then this is simply spread on a short time scale, this is spread on a longer time scale, but overall it's the same total energy, so you get 1 over T as time. There are corrections to this, which can be described analytically. Almost analytically, I will not go into that, which can explain the deviation between 1 over T to 1 over 1.3. So I'll skip that. Dan will talk more about this, and Udi already spoke about this in the context of supernova, but I just want to get here the background once more to see where we are standing. So this is what is happening when the radioactive material is expanding and cooling. This is the photosphere, which is at tau equals C over VV. We see radiation escaping from this region. We don't see radiation coming from the center. So in one dynamical time scale, photons escape from here. And this means that the light curve have basically two regimes. In the first regime, the light curve increases, and this increases because this photosphere moves inwards in Lagrangian coordinates, so we see more and more of the star until we get to a peak, which is roughly at the time that everything is transparent. And at the same, and once we go to the peak, everything is transparent, then we simply see less and less energy because the radioactive power which is powering this goes down as time goes on, and so we expect here to see something like T to the minus 1.3, which is the radioactive decay. So this is the expectation. And you
said that the tau C over V is the photosphere.
Yes.
The photosphere and the trapping radius are the same in this event.
The
photosphere, so tau 1/2, and the trapping radius are the same.
Well,
just terminology. You meant tau equals C over V, not the photosphere.
Oh, okay.
Not the tau equals.
Okay. So they're not the same.
No.
Okay.
I'm glad that somebody understood the question faster than me. No, I'm sorry. It's my fault. So the point is that the photons are escaping from here. Everything which is produced outside from here will escape. It doesn't necessarily escape with the temperature that exists here, but it escapes. Okay. Now, this can be translated, this very simple model, to a set of simple equations, some which were all shown before, but I just want to get to the dependence on the opacity, which is important. So that's, I'll go over them quickly. This is the condition that diffusion time is equal to the expansion time. So this gives us here, the this relationship gives us, relates the diffusion time to the expansion time. So at the time t, I see a fraction m of the mass where m of v is the amount of mass moving faster than v. So at time t, I see only the outer shell. And there, this is an equation for v, which I see at time t. Once I know what is m from here, I can solve, I can tell what is the luminosity, because the luminosity will be the energy generation rate times this mass. And we already said that the energy generation rate will be some constant time t over t zero to the power minus alpha 1.3 times the total mass. So this is, this tells me how much, how, what is the luminosity, energy generation rate times the mass which is observed. Now, when this will be maximum, the maximum will be when I'll see all the mass. And this is happening at the peak time, which is the square root of the opacity times the total mass of the ejecta divided by 4 pi c times v. V is the average, the typical luminosity there. And in terms of relevant units, if I take 0.01 solar masses and velocity of about 0.1 c and opacity of 10 centimeters square per gram, this is, this peak is around 5 days. So this is just an order of magnitude, but for this high opacity. And it goes, this peak time goes like the opacity to the power of half. Once I know the peak time, I can plug it into this equation and I can get what is the peak luminosity. And the peak luminosity following this will be about 2.5 × 10⁴ ergs per second. And this is in units of, again, velocity of 0.1 c and optical depth of 10 and 0.01 solar masses ejected. Now, a critical question here is, what is the opacity? And here there was an interesting, very interesting development just in November, where two independent groups, Dan Kaysen and Jennifer Barnes, and independently Tanaka and Otto Kazaka in Kyoto, realized that the opacity should be fairly large. And the reason that the opacity, are you going to discuss this tomorrow? So this will be explained in more detail by Dan tomorrow, but this is large because of the lanthanides which are there, which are very heavy elements, and these very heavy elements leads to this huge opacity. Because of this, because of the fact that T max depend on the square root of kappa, this means that with larger opacity, the peak will be longer. Before that, people expected the peak to be at about 0.5 days. Now it moved to 1 to 0.5 days. Now it moved to about 5 days, weaker and redder. This was, historically, this was very, very nice, because this was published or advertised in May of 2013. And the first macronova, or the first observed candidate of macronova, was infrared signal, which was detected in June. So if it was the time scale was opposite, just because of coincidence, people would have thought that this was, well, the theory did not work nicely, so the theorists played with it and fixed it. But this was a prediction rather than a fit to the observation. And indeed, the 13.06.03b, the first candidate for macronova or kilonova, was observed as an infrared signal, 9 days, but in the rest frame of the system, 6 days after the event. So it was more or less in agreement with this prediction of here. So this is what. Now came the neutron star merger that we saw in this August. And with this, some surprises, at least surprises compared to what happened, what we expected, given this observation of macronova. of 13.603. And this is the bolometric light curve. There are many, this is from a paper by Mansi, but there are various other papers with similar results. So we see here the bolometric light curve, and you see here that it goes, it peaks here at about half a day or so. The black body temperature is about, the first detections is about 11,000 degrees, so this is definitely not an infrared signal. And the black body radius increases nicely, corresponding to implied velocity, kind of 0.3 to 0.1 C. So this was in accordance with the expectation. But this early light curve was, the early strong signal here was surprising, at least compared to what we expected. So how can we explain this? One thing for sure is that there is no way to fix this with optical depths of 10 throughout. At the beginning, we must have material with a lighter composition. And the question is lighter composition in the sense that the opacity is not at the level of 10, it's more like 1. But the question is how low do we need to go? Do we need to go to very low luminosity, to very low opacity or not? And here, again, in the context of what Udi said yesterday, the cocoon has some important aspects in this part of the work. This is the cocoon at the time of breakout. And actually, these figures are from a figure that we posted and published even before this event. And there are two signals contributing here to a blue early signal here. One part is simply the cooling emission of the cocoon. The cocoon breaks out, and just like in the regular story of the expanding material, this is a hot material. Even if you don't supply any energy, this hot material will cool and emit radiation. So this is the cooling component. So there are two components here. The first one, what is this here? Yeah, the first one is the cooling emission. But eventually, as you wait, just like in the story of supernova, after some cooling emission, the cooling emission disappears because of the adiabatic expansion, the radioactive decay begins to kick in. And then we have this additional component due to the radioactive decay. Now, this time scale here, which is difficult to see, is actually shorter than the time scale that was observed here. But what I want to stress here, the following. And this is actually what we used later after the event in models that were trying to fit this event. That the cocoon material here, at the time of about half a day today, is still moving at a mildly relativistic expansion. And this gives an additional boost to the matter, additional boost to the observed radiation by about a factor of 2 to 3. And this additional boost helps somewhat explaining this early signal that we see here. So I don't suggest that we see the cooling radiation because the cooling radiation was too short for that. But there is a contribution here in the early phase for a boosted cocoon emission, for a boosted emission, relativistically boosted emission coming from the radioactive decay taking place in the cocoon, which is expanding towards us. Now, is it enough to have high opacity? The answer is no. Still, even with this factor, if the opacity was 10, it would not have worked. We must have lower opacity at the beginning, at the initial phase. So the thing that we observed here is a combination of high opacity material, which was dominating later on, and low opacity material, which was important in the early phase for the contribution, for what we saw here. But the thing that I just wanted to stress is the importance of this relativistic push that helps somewhat to alleviate the need for very low opacity. You can explain everything if you just say this was just a regular expansion, non-relativistic, mildly relativistic expansion without the Lorentz boost, if you sufficiently reduce the opacity. But this somehow limits the need to reduce the opacity too much. Okay. Yeah. One more thing which you can do from this observed light curve. From the emission here, from the early emission, one can try to estimate what is the minimal mass which was ejected. Surprisingly, it is difficult. And the difficulty arises from some nuclear physics coincidence. There is one isotope in the, I forgot the name, I'm sorry, in the first peak, which dominates the cooling, the radioactive decay at around one day. And it is not clear if you produce the first peak or don't produce the first peak in this merger. If you produce the first peak and produce this isotope, then this almost doubles the emissivity at around one day. And if it doubles the emissivity, then you need less material. So there is uncertainty, but there is no way that you can go below about 0.2 solar masses. Sorry, 0.02 solar masses. Even if you add this isotope and you try to enhance the radioactive decay. So this is a sort of a limit to the amount of mass which was ejected there. Okay, in the remaining time, I want to talk about the consistency of this and the whole idea of neutron star mergers with the model, with the idea that neutron star mergers are the major or only source of radioactive decay, of R process elements in the universe. So there are a few steps here. The first step is the simplest one. And I'll explain everything on this diagram. And this diagram describes how much material is ejected, is produced in each event, how much R process material is produced per event. And this axis here is how many events I have in a galaxy per million years. And it is clear that if I know what is the total number of R process that I need, that the product of the rate times the mass should be on one of these lines. And these lines give me the amount of matter that I need to produce in order to generate all the R process elements that we have in the universe. So this is the range of uncertainty here about the total amount of R process elements. And the product M times R is a constant, and this is the line of M times R. But this is highly degenerate. And if you have a supernova, if it is produced by supernova, then the rate of supernova is somewhere here. So supernova should put each, if each supernova produces a small amount of R process, this is good enough. Or on the other hand, I can have events like mergers, which are rare, but each one will have to produce a lot of material. So this is trivial. But the next question is, can we break the degeneracy here? And the answer is surprisingly yes. And this can be done if we have radioactive elements with the right age. If you have a radioactive element, then of course once you produce it, it begins to decay. And you have two extreme cases. This is what you have in if the elements are rare. You produce, and then it decays, and then you wait.
Not the elements are rare, the events are
rare. If the events are rare, sorry. These elements are also rare.
The element is constant in the two cases you're trying to compare.
Yes. I produce the same number of elements, but I produce the same number of atoms. But in one case, I produced a lot in a single explosion and they decay. And in the other case, I produce a small amount, but many explosions, one after the other. If the events are frequent, then regardless of where this is time, regardless where I am, I will see some high, not high, but I'll see some average amount. There won't be large fluctuations. On the other hand, if the events are rare, then every once in a while I'll see very high amount of radioactive elements, but on a typical situation I'll see very small amount. So a usual observer will see a very small amount of this element. And the comparison of what is rare and what is not rare is the ratio, is the time of the radioactive decay compared to the rate of the events. If the radioactive lifetime times the rate is larger than one, then the event is frequent, and otherwise it is rare. And luckily, nature produces an element like this, plutonium-244, which is radioactive element with about 80 million years of lifetime of 80 million years. And remarkably, this element was produced in fairly large quantities in the early solar system. Now, the early solar system was produced 4.5 million years ago, so we don't see this element, but we see the daughter elements of this plutonium-44. And we can identify from that, and this is the range of that exists in the early solar system. At the same time, we can try to measure what is the deposition of this plutonium on Earth now and compare to the amount that was deposited on the early solar system. So this was done by Wollner et al. And Michael Pohl, who is here, was one of the co-authors of this paper. And this is done by digging into the to the deep sea sediments and taking some samples. And from this, you can measure the amount of current plutonium which was falling onto the solar system in the last few million years. And you can see here that there is at least one, but maybe two or even three orders of magnitude comparing this rate to this rate. And if you go back to here, this suggests that we are in this situation and not in this situation, because of this large fluctuation between what was observed in one point of time and what is observed now. And this was done with plutonium, but it was done by other groups with other elements that show similar behavior. So this is a kind of what is expected in this case of the situation for a time evolution. But what is important, if I go back to here, to this graph, this now gives us a very different curve from this linear lines here. This is the allowed region in which we allow such a high fluctuations. It completely rules out the core collapse supernova. This is the rate of core collapse supernova. It completely ruled out because the rate of core collapse supernova is so large that if this was the case, we would have seen the same amount of plutonium-244 at all times. There will be no fluctuations. So this suggests that the region is around here with a mass ejection of about 1% of of solar mass and about average rate of 10 events per million years in the galaxy. There are other ways to explore this, and this is by looking at dwarf galaxies. And if we go to dwarf galaxies, Then what we see here is the luminosity, which is a proxy for the mass of the galaxy. And this is the amount of iron. And this is on the same same galaxies, the amount of europium. And europium is a classical R process element because it's one which is can be spectroscopically identified. And you see here reticum 2. Here you see sort of a linear relationship, but here you see this reticum 2, which is far above what you should expect for its given mass. And then you can try to see, okay, given this data, you can try to guess what is the production rate of iron per, per event and per galaxy here, and what is the production rate of R process elements, in particular europium, in this case here. So we first do this exercise for just the production of the iron, and we get, which is believed to be produced by supernova, and we get this cross here, which is we get this, and this work was done by with Paz, who is here, and also with Kenta, who is not here. So if you look at this, this is the maximum likelihood curve. This is the observed, the expectation from supernova. So this is a sanity check. It shows us that what this whole process that we are doing makes sense. And this is now the equivalent thing that we do now for the R process elements. It gives us these curves. And this is estimated now, not as the absolute rate, but rate per supernova, how many R process event, producing events we have per supernova. So we say we know the rate of supernova, we know what is the rate per supernova. So we have a completely independent measurement from this measurement here, and we plot it on the same curve. And it sits here. So things begin to be comfortable because there is a kind of reassuring, because this analysis of the dwarf galaxies, which was completely independent of the analysis of this plutonium, is overlapping with this linear line, which we know that we must be around, more or less at the same place. So this is beginning to be reassuring. How much time do I have? Okay. Okay, so this allows me to make an important digression to remarks about binary neutron stars. And these remarks followed from the observation of the first double pulsar. First, I think, and only double pulsar in It was double pulsar for a while, and now one of them is pointing to others, but it will come back. Also, the original binary pulsar will disappear completely. The Holson-Taylor pulsar should disappear, I think, in about 10 years or something like this. So if you want to observe it, you should observe it quickly. Because this is because of the precession of the beam in the binary system. So this was observed. So we have a system in which we know both pulsars. And because of this, we can know with great details. And luckily, the system was also almost edge on. So we can measure numerous effects, and we can measure with great accuracy the masses of both pulsars and the the distance to them, the eccentricity of the orbit and everything. The remarkable thing, there are a few remarkable things. First, the system is almost on circular orbit. The eccentricity is very low, 0.08. So it's almost circular. And the second thing which was remarkable, that the system was basically in the galactic plane. It was not above the galactic plane, it was not below the galactic plane. Why is this remarkable? Because if we have a regular star, a neutron star and a regular star, to make it a double neutron star, this will have to collapse to in a supernova. And as it collapses as a supernova, it ejects some of its mass and collapses to a neutron star. Now, this ejection of some of the mass changes its orbit, which was circular before, to an elliptical orbit. And actually, if you eject too much mass, it will change it to hyperbolic orbit, and this will be torn apart. So this is not the case here because it was circular. The usual way to prevent the system from the usual idea how the systems do not break apart or how to prevent it from breaking or from being too eccentric is that we invoke kick velocity. We suggest that this material was ejected, but it was not ejected. It was ejected with some linear momentum, which was in some direction. And this linear momentum reduced the linear momentum now of this deformed neutron stars. And this can enable us to have a circular orbit. Yes?
Why do we assume that the eccentricity is low to begin with before the supernova?
Oh, because this system lives for quite a long time as a neutron star, as a star. They must not be too far apart. Otherwise, they will not merge. They will not reach their final stage, stage which is so nearby. So there will be tidal forces, and the tidal forces will circularize the orbit. So we have to we can invoke this, but this comes with a penalty, and the penalty is the whole motion, the whole system now is a center of mass motion in this direction, and actually the kick velocity, which is needed to the system will have a center of mass motion in any case, but the kick velocity which is needed to circularize the orbit will give will increase the center of mass velocity. Now, just from the fact that the system is in the galactic plane, we know that we don't want a large center of mass velocity. Because if it is, the stars are oscillating up and down in more or less harmonic motion in the galactic potential. And if you're moving with harmonic motion in the galactic potential, when is your largest motion? You're faster at the plane. So you don't spend a lot of time in the plane. So if you catch something in the plane, this means that you don't move very far. And this means that you don't have a large velocity. So just this fact led us to suggest that the system does not have a large proper motion, in contradiction to standard lore about core collapse and such systems. And remarkably, this was verified later on by measuring the motion of this pulsar very accurately. I will skip this example. And so this is what we have here is for this system. This is to get the observed parameters of the system. This will be the kick velocity. This will be the mass which is kicked. And the system is here. This means that the system, just from this observation, that the system must have been born with a kick velocity which was less than 25 kilometers per second, much less than what is discussed for regular pulsars. But more remarkably, the mass ejection should be less than about, the initial estimate were about less than about 0.15 solar masses. Now, mass ejection of, this is the total mass which was ejected from this star. This is very different from all the regular supernova that we heard about this week. So this system, this second pulsar here, was not formed as a regular supernova, unlike the predictions which were made before that. There were several papers published right after the system was ejected saying that this system was born with ejection of 1.5 to 2 solar masses, and it will be moving at 200 kilometers per second. The system was measured later on, and it is the velocity is less than 20 kilometers per second, the center of the proper motion of the system. So the system is not moving at all. And this verifies this prediction that we had that it will not move. But it is most important, it was not born in a regular supernova. Now, this was this particular system, but this can be generalized to other systems. And this is an old figure, but you can see here the ellipticity of the various pulsars, the binary pulsars, which were known at that time. And you see there's quite a few of them have low eccentricities. And at the same time, these guys that have low eccentricities are also have low masses. So the idea, so it's possible that there is a, that the low eccentricity goes with low masses of the pulsars. And this suggests that there is a different channel of formation of these neutron stars. And this was actually confirmed with the later work that we did, again, with Paz, who is here, by estimating the what is happening to the pulsars, to the binary pulsars in the galaxy. So this is the eccentricity, and this is the commutative distribution as far as eccentricity. And you see that there is a large group of objects with low eccentricity from the, among the binary pulsars. And just to stress the point, the binary pulsars are points. There's almost no tidal interaction between them. They can be completely, the tidal interaction be completely neglected. So there is no way that you can reduce by tidal interaction or some way like this the eccentricity. You can reduce the eccentricity somewhat by the gravitational radiation emission, which reduces the eccentricity. But this system did not have enough time to reduce the eccentricity sufficiently to such a low value. So they must be born here. And so what we tried is we tried a situation in which we said arbitrarily, we take all the pulsar, all the binary pulsars in the galaxy, divide them to two groups, and each group will have a different distributions of kick velocities and masses, and see what we get. And we find indeed that the best fit, and this is the fit that we get, this is the theoretical fit. This is if we try to use a single population with a single kick velocity and a single distribution for kick velocities and masses, it doesn't fit at all the observation. This is what we get if we assume that there are two populations, and we find that indeed there is one population which is more like the standard one, and these guys have a kick typical velocities of about 150 kilometers per second. This is the large range of error here. And typical solar masses which are ejected are about one or more solar masses. But there is another group, and this is the majority. About two-thirds of the guys are sitting here. And they have a kick velocity which is less than 10 kilometers per second and a mass ejection which is less than 0.1 solar masses. And these are two-thirds of the observed binary systems in the galaxy. And this was done about 3 or 4 years ago. And since then, 4 or 5 new binary pulsars were found. And they're more or less divided according to this. Two-thirds in this group and one-third in this group. So this tells us, when we think about binary evolution, that binary evolution, that the binary neutron stars may come from a very different channels than from two different channels, and one of them is very different from the usual channel formation. Why is this important in this context? Because one of the criticisms against this whole idea of using dwarf galaxies and actually against producing our process by binary mergers in dwarf galaxies, that the binding velocity, the typical circular velocities of this object is so small that a binary neutron star may be kicked out of such a galaxy if it has a center of mass motion of 50 or more kilometers per second. But this tells us that many of them do not have such a large center of mass motion, and we don't have to worry about these kicks. Okay, so I almost finished. So far, all that we know that our process is produced in rare events with high yield. We did not prove that this, so far, that these are neutron star mergers. This is our, with rare events and high yield, and in particular, Thielmann, Friedel Thielmann, a very good friend with whom I worked on some of these ideas, actually have a completely different model of a magnetic jet-driven supernova. So this suggests that some rare supernova are completely driven by magnetic jet, and in these magnetic jets, the conditions for producing our process are okay. So these are also rare events with high yield. What is correct? But now we put on the same curve the rate of compact binary mergers, as we can infer from short gamma ray burst or for mergers in the galaxy. And this was prior to 1708-17. There are several macronova candidates, so they are in this range. So this agrees. We may say that this is a lucky coincidence, but it agrees. We can put on top of this estimate of mass surrounding neutron star mergers, which I mentioned, that coming from the time distribution of short gamma ray bursts, which is also along this range, so everything seems to fit. But here came this event. This event is here. The rate is slightly higher. The error bars are quite large. It's in the ballpark. And there are two curves here, depending on whether you assume that the R process elements that neutron star merger are producing everything, including to the first peak, or just this is if they produce also the first peak, this is if they produce just the second peak. So things seems to work, and this event is just in the right place to be consistent. But, and I'm glad that I don't have time to talk about it, if you try to put this into simple galactic evolution model of the rate as function of time, there are problems, but I'm very happy that I don't have time to talk about them.
The chemical enrichment in this dwarf galaxy actually is proved by this the R-plus element formed inside the nearby more massive galaxy instead is itself. This is my thoughts. How do you think?
You want to have that the You want to suggest that the R process element were produced by nearby galaxy and transported to this small galaxy?
Yeah.
It's very difficult because these galaxies are very pristine. They are the mass ratio between the stars and the total mass of the galaxy is small. And this is understood in the sense that once you have the first wave of star formation, then most of the gas was ejected from these galaxies. So these are model for what happened in the very early universe. So I don't see how you expect that these galaxies were able to accrete mass from a nearby galaxy. It is possible, but the most natural explanation was that there was a wave of star formation, there was a wave of supernova. The supernova produced the iron. And also among all this, in many cases, there was not even a single neutron star merger because they are so small. And if there was not a single neutron star mergers, these galaxies do not have any R process element. But in rare cases, and this is why only now there are two cases like this, you see R process elements. And when you see the R process elements, they are much more abundant than you expect, than average. And they're much more abundant because a single event produces a lot of R process elements. That's the whole story. So this is exactly in agreement with this idea that rare elements, that rare events are producing a lot of material. And in most of this galaxy, there's almost no event like this. And every once in a while, you have one event which is doing the job. There are other problems with the magnetized jets. To produce this R process in magnetized jets, you have to push all the parameters to an extreme case in the phase space. So,
the question, you said that you think that there are two different ways to produce this binary neutron star.
Yes.
Do you see any other properties which are in between these two populations?
But the two dominant ones which exist now are of this rare type. I mean, the two shortest ones to merge are from this kind of new formation process, and only the classical binary pulsar, the Yulsen-Taylor pulsar, is the shortest one to merge with the other process. The observed ratio is 2 to 1.
Yeah, but you need to correct for the time.
I don't think there is good enough information to correct for that. We tried to. I don't think there is good enough information. But there is another factor which distinguishes between the two systems. This other system tends to be lighter masses. The two in the J0737 is 1.25 and 1.3 solar masses. They are on the low end. So this is another indication in the completely independent that there may be two channels. This tend to be the lighter neutron stars.
More questions?
The abundance analysis you did with European, can you also use the other R process elements? Or why did you choose this particular?
I'm not an observer, but this is chosen because it has a typical lines which are easier to observe. There are other lines, there are other elements which are produced, but as far as I understand, this is the easiest one to identify. This is just a question that you need a line which is easy to identify in stars. It's a very difficult measurement because you have to do spectroscopy on stars which are usually not very bright stars because you're usually looking at old population of stars. So these are low mass stars which are lived long to get an old population. So for this low metallicity object,
but
so
now
it's
the brightest now.
They are not giants. They are usually regular stars, as far as I understand. But I'm not an observer. I don't know. I just look at the abundance table that they give me. Sorry. With the larger robots. If you, no, there is the amount of luck which was in this event is incredible. I mean, just take the fact that Fermi was the GBM was supposed to be switched off in few minutes because they were going into the South Atlantic anomaly. So this is just one among many examples of Lux, which was there, I mean. And the whole LIGO was supposed to be switched off in 2 weeks. So if you begin to count Lux here, the next time that LIGO team goes on, I'm buying a lottery ticket with one of them. It's a very good investment. Well, but you see the lower edge here. Oh, yeah, but about the rates, there is an independent measure, and this is from the optical signal, because we saw the optical light curve, the optical, and one thing, exercise which was done immediately after that, was to factor in the properties of the transient, or the optical transient, into the detectability of PTF. And we know that there was nothing else like this which was detected in the 4 years that PTF was working. And this gives this upper limit for the rate of events with a similar optical signal. So thank you for asking, because I forgot to mention this line. So this has to be, if this is a typical in terms of the light, the optical light, the rate should be below this. It is consistent with what you call beginner's luck, because we are here and this is the upper limit.